Words of joy and hope. It is the solemnity of Christ the King, the 34th Sunday in Ordinary Time, the year B, and Gospel of John 18:33-37, and the commentaries by Father Fernando Armelini. Pilate said to Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?" Pilate answered, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here." So Pilate said to him, "Then you are a king." Jesus answered, "You say I am a king, and for this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." A good Sunday for all, sisters and brothers. We have come to the conclusion of the liturgical year, and today we celebrate the solemnity of Christ the King. It is a feast that has been instituted recently in 1925, at a dramatic time in Europe. The First World War had just ended, and the Second was already being prepared. In Europe, a true delirium for absolute power was spreading. It had already taken place, the March on Rome in Italy, and therefore the fascist regime had already begun. In Russia, Stalin was already there. In Germany, Nazism was about to arrive. And also Spain and Portugal were about to fall into the hands of totalitarian regimes. It seemed that everyone was ambitious to dominate over the world and over people in an absolute way. It is in this context that Pope Pius XI institutes the Feast of Christ the King. Everyone wanted to dominate the world, and the goal of the Pope was to affirm that history did not belong to the powers of this world, but to Christ. The fallacies of these totalitarian regimes were already visible as they were starting to implement these totalitarian projects. It is a feast that must be taken with caution, because the royalty of Christ can be taken in the wrong way. There is always the danger of interpreting in according to the criteria of this world, and even would say that even the popes were not always clear on what the royalty of Christ consists of. And without going back to the past when we had the struggles for investiture of the popes, we know that until recently, until Paul VI, the popes were given the tiara of the three kingdoms at the time of the coronation. And they were proclaimed father of princes and kings, rulers of the world, and vicar of Christ on earth. And this is not the royalty that we will see in today's gospel text. What is the true royalty of Christ? It is the last Sunday of the liturgical year, and this invites us to reflect on the end of the world and also the end of our life. In the history of the world, we have seen many kingdoms that have fought against each other to dominate the world and succeed one another. We have seen in the past the kingdom of the nobility, the kingdom of the dynasties, then the kingdom of the rich who succeeded the nobility, the kingdom of arms by those who had in their hands the power of force. So let us try to ask ourselves if at the end of our life we have to belong to one of these kingdoms. Which kingdom do we want to belong to? We must ask ourselves this question because the option we make will depend on that, the success of our life. If we choose a kingdom that in the end we lose, then we will have wasted our life. The text of today's gospel helps us reflect so that we do not waste our lives and that we choose to be part of the kingdom that will be the winner at the end. Perhaps on earth there will be other victorious kingdoms, but we are interested in how it will end. This is why the gospel has been placed, this gospel, at the end of the liturgical year. We already know well the kingdoms of this world. No need to describe them. But we do not have a clear idea of what the kingdom of God consists of. And Jesus has begun his preaching in Galilee, announcing that the time has come and that the kingdom of God is present here and now. The expression kingdom of God is very important in the gospel. It appears 104 times because Jesus has wanted to start in this world a completely new kingdom, not only slightly different of the kingdoms of this world, but the opposite of the kingdom of this world. So let us now turn to the text of the gospel today. Pilate had entered the praetorium again. It is worth setting this story because the evangelist John presents seven scenes in the narrative of the process of Jesus. Seven scenes that refer to royalty. Therefore, it is a subject that is very important. And the seven scenes are defined according to the movements and changes of Pilate. To set the mood, you can see behind me the Palace of Herod, which later served as Praetorium where Pilate came during Easter time. It was during this time of Easter that Pilate pronounced Jesus' sentence of condemnation. And you can see the palace. Notice that it has two parts. And we know it very well because Josephus Flavius describes it in detail, this historian. It had two parts, one to the north and one to the south, the Caesarion and the Agrippeon. Agrippa was a great friend of General Augustus, and of course Caesar. It could not be otherwise that Herod the Great could name his palaces. Then in the center there was a large patio, a garden in the center, and it is important, notice the agora, the square, that was facing these palaces, and see that there is a door to the palace. This is important because when the temple authorities present themselves to Pilate, they are the chief priest and some people, they showed up at this door. But they could not enter to avoid contamination with the pagan and with a pagan territory. At that night, they had to celebrate Easter. In the Gospel of John, Pilate is presented with these movements from the door where he speaks to the Jews who have presented him to Jesus, and he goes to the Caesarion where Jesus is, back and forth several times. Pilate will continually make the movements between the people and Jesus. The people are the religious powers of Israel who want to get rid of this character who has condemned them, who has annoyed them, because he, this personage, Jesus, preached a face of God and a religion completely different from the one they preached. After this setting, let us say that the scene that is now narrated in today's Gospel text is the second scene in the Gospel of John. The first scene takes place at that door that faces the Agora, the square, the plaza. And now you can see it better. The people and the chief presented their complaints to Pilate, who received them at the door. And Pilate asked them what accusation they had against this man. The answer was very generic. If it were not a criminal, we would not have brought him to you. Who is this Pilate? A word about this man. He had been actually forgotten by historians, although Josephus Flavius speaks a little about him, and Philo of Alexandria has a very bad impression of Pilate. He says that he was corrupt, licentious, cruel. He robbed people, condemned people without trial. But the Gospel presents a more benign image of Pilate. Even in the tradition, later on, he ended up being one who had converted. Pilate pronounced Jesus' condemnation, but he's not the true culprit. The responsible of the death of Jesus are those who have delivered him to Pilate. Pilate has made a career because, in all probability, he was a friend of Seiano, who was in charge in Rome in the year 30, while Tiberius was in Capri, semi-insane. And that is how Pilate made a good political career. So, forgotten by historians, but remembered every Sunday around the world, precisely for the scene that we are invited to reflect on today, the scene of royalty. In this dialogue between Jesus and Pilate, which is the second scene, Pilate re-enters with Jesus and starts with a dialogue. He wants to know what Jesus has done. In the background, you see now the Caesarion. I have told you that we know very well about this, what it was like, because it is described in detail by Josephus Flavius. And you can see it there on my back. Now, the first question Pilate asks is, "Are you the king of the Jews?" The interrogation with Jesus is centered on royalty. However, this interrogation does not correspond with the accusations made against Jesus. They had presented him as a criminal, a political agitator. Pilate says to Jesus, "I heard people saying that they are waiting for a king. Are you the one, the king of the Jews?" Jesus replies, "Do you ask that on your own or because others have told you about me?" Jesus answers with another question. This question that Jesus asks is very important. It means, what kind of royalty do you accuse me of? What kind of questions are you asking me? If it is you who ask the question, then it has a meaning. If instead it is a question that you ask me because others have told you about me, then if I'm the king of the Jews, yes, then the answer has another meaning. Because if your question corresponds to what the Jews have told you, then it means that I am a king. The Messiah they await, the Lord's anointed, the king of whom the prophets have spoken about. Therefore, a religious they mention, first of all. But if you are the one who asked the question, then it has another meaning. It means you ask me if I am a king who will bring problems to Tiberius and the kingdom you represent, the kingdom of this world? Pilate's response is a bit grumpy. He says, am I a Jew? What kind of question do you ask me? If I ask you this question, it is because I am interested in the royalty of Tiberius. And I have no interest in being questioned. Your nations and the chief priests have given you to me. What have you done? Here the evangelist John exposes the guilt of the Jewish representatives. It has been Annas, Caiaphas, annoyed by the person of Jesus that was unbearable to them. Jesus threw out all their power, and John makes clear that was the religious authority's responsibility. Pilate wants to see clearly, and Jesus answers, you, Pilate, think of the reign of Tiberius, not of any other. So let's talk about royalty. My royalty does not come from this world. And pay special attention, the evangelical text does not say my kingdom is not of this world, because this expression will give rise to several ambiguities. It would mean that the kingdom of Jesus is not of this world, that it is later in paradise. And in this world, those who dominate have the last word. And they rule here. And then, but Jesus will reign on the other side. That is, if your kingdom is not of this world, but instead the kingdom of Jesus is out of this world. But the reign of God, the kingdom of God, must be realized. It is for this world, but does not come from the world, this world. Jesus is very clear, and I may add, Jesus was speaking in Greek with Pilate. Jesus knew the Greek language at least a little. Pilate spoke Greek. Therefore, the word that Jesus uses is not the kingdom of this world, but my kingdom does not come from this world. What does it mean? Does not come from this world indicates the origin. It does not originate from this world. It does not come from the proposals of greatness, of dominion that comes from this world. It is the origin. It is not worldly. It does not come from the world, from the kingdom of beasts, because the kingdom of this world are based on competition and all seek to dominate one over the other. Jesus says, my kingdom does not come from here. It comes from above. It does not come from the world. In the animal kingdom, you fight. There is another kingdom. It comes from another source. It is not of this world, but it is established in this world. Sometimes we translate from this world, my kingdom is not of this world, but it's not so. A kingdom from this world does not interest anyone because justice is not done here. You can even die of hunger. You can compete with one another. Evil is done. Then will Jesus' kingdom will be in the hereafter only? No. This is where the kingdom of Christ is realized. But its logic is the opposite to what is of this world. There are other values, not the values of worldliness. My kingdom refers to this world, but it does not come from the criteria of the world. It's a completely new logic, different. We ask now, what are the differences between these kingdoms? Those who are of this world, with the logic of this world, and the one that comes from heaven, with another logic, the logic of God. How is the kingdom that comes from worldliness? I would say that it's precisely the one that Jesus was tempted about to build at the beginning of the gospel. The temptations of Jesus are presented, and the temptations of Jesus refer precisely to the kingdom. Jesus was tempted to build a kingdom that comes from this world. It was a diabolical temptation. What was the diabolical temptation about? The evil that are the suggestions that come from the criteria of the world, this is the evil one, suggested to Jesus, I am going to teach you how a kingdom is built. If you want people to follow you, you must be one who knows how to dominate. You must impose yourself, and then everyone will submit to you. And if necessary, well, these are the criteria of this world. You can resort to injustice, dishonesty, violence, oppression to dominate and establish your kingdom. These are the criteria of the kingdom that comes from the world. And the evil one had told Jesus, if you want to be successful, if you want to be considered great among people, follow this criteria. It is exactly the script that we have seen repeated throughout history. So, what is the difference? The first, Jesus tries to make Pilate understand the difference between these two kingdoms. Jesus says, if my kingdom were of this world, that is, if I followed the criteria of this world, what is it that my followers would have done? They would have fought for me. They would have taken up arms, because these are the criteria of the world. The kingdom of this world is the realm of struggle, of war, marked by violence. And we know that Jesus has rejected this kingdom based on the strength and dominion. Remember that he told Peter, put your sword in the scabbard. Those who lay their hands on the sword end up dying by the sword. It is inevitable that in the encounter between violent ones, one will be able to come out victorious, but then another day, he will be defeated. And in fact, in the Gospel of John, Peter does not understand this new kingdom that is not based on force. Peter was one of those who still thought that the kingdom could be established following the criteria of the world. And that is why he resorts to the sword. Jesus says that is not the way the kingdom is established. And now Jesus explains it to Pilate. The first characteristic of my kingdom is that yours is based on strength, mine is not. Then Pilate says to him, then you are a king. And Jesus says to him, you say it, I am a king. And Pilate does not understand, how can there be a king who does not fight? And Jesus continues, for that I was born, for that I came to the world, to bear witness to the truth. It is difficult for Pilate to understand this discourse. What was Jesus trying to say? Okay, Jesus was speaking a Semitic language. When a Semite speaks of truth, it does not mean telling or not telling lies. We also have a clear idea of what truth means, of what really means. For example, when we say it is real coffee, we mean this is not a substitute, it's not a derivative, it is not a byproduct. It is true coffee. It corresponds to the identity of coffee. When we say this is a true man, if he's a criminal, we say he's not a real man, he's a violent man, he's bad, similar to the wild beasts, he's not a true man. A true priest, we know what it means. Or a true Christian, he's welcoming, he loves even the enemies, we say he's a true Christian. It does not mean that they do not have faults, but that it corresponds to their identity. What kind of truth does Jesus bear witness to? He came to the world to bear witness to the truth. First of all, the truth about God. A God very different from the pagan gods, different from God preached by the preachers of the Jewish spirituality and worshipped by the priests of the temple. It is not the righteous God. He is not a legislator God who then responds with reprisals against those that do not follow his commandments. He is a God who loves unconditionally, loves people madly, a God who is not sitting on a throne but is at the service of man. This is the truth about God. And Jesus came to bear witness to this true God. The rest are people's inventions. Then he gives testimony of the true man. He came to give testimony on the truth about man. The true man is not the one who dominates over others. This was already done by the beasts, and we imitate them sometimes. It is the animal kingdom. Man has received God's filiation. Therefore, he is capable of loving and loving without measure, even to donate his life for his own enemy, if it is to save him. This is a true man. And Jesus came to bear witness to this truth. The rest is a lie. The man who follows the logic of this world is not true man. Then there is another truth. The real kingdom. We must place ourselves on the side of the kingdom we want to build. What is it? Is it one kingdom that later on will be defeated by a stronger one according to the criteria and logic of this world? Or is the kingdom of Christ, the true kingdom that Jesus has witnessed, which is the kingdom of the Lamb in the midst of wolves? And to make the option for this kingdom means to give the adhesion to his proposal of man, who serves, who gives himself totally out for love, to build love in the world. The kingdom he proposes is not to be served by others, but to serve others. If Pilate had been able to understand the kingdom Jesus was proposing, he too would have been a true man, free. But instead he remained a slave to the kingdom of this world. He would have understood that being a true person would be a servant of the brothers and sisters, to possess true glory, that which comes from God, not from the glory of this world. Pilate was not able to understand Jesus. It was very complicated because Jesus was doing a kind of an earthquake with all the criteria that Pilate had in his mind, in his head. So Jesus continues saying, "Whoever is on the side of the truth, hear my voice. The one who seeks the truth, the true face of God, the true face of man, the true kingdom, the one that endures, the one that God is building, hears my voice." And Pilate responds with the famous phrase, "And what is the truth?" Pilate has not understood. And he could have waited for the answer, but instead he went out to tell the Jews that they were waiting for a sentence, and he told them, "I do not find fault in this man." Pilate should have waited for the answer to the question, "What is the truth?" The truth, it's about the three truths that I have tried to explain. The truth that Jesus came to bear witness in the world. Now, Pilate is a typical character, similar to one who has in mind the image of a true God, of a true man, but is not willing to accept it. Who is that real man, the successful man, for Pilate? It is Tiberius, Sejanus, his protector. Those are the real men for him. And when he says to Jesus, "What is the truth?" he had to stop and wait for the explanation, but instead he goes out. He does not need this kingdom, this testimony about the truth. He already has his truth, his true man, and does not want to hear other arguments. This may be also the conclusion for us today on the reflection on the gospel text. We can make the same mistake as Pilate. Having in mind the conception about truth, about God, about true man of the kingdom, and not letting us convince and put into practice the kingdom of Jesus. That is not the kingdom of dominion, but the kingdom of one who becomes a servant for the sake of the brothers and sisters. I wish everyone that you may reflect on this kingdom so that at the end of your life, at the end of the world, be part of this kingdom, that you be the builder of this kingdom. Otherwise, you will be left out of God's history. I wish everyone a good Sunday and a good week.